Michigan funds its schools. There you have the title, but there you also have the line that is not just a decorative element, it is actually how Michigan funds its schools. So what I want to do is I want to talk very briefly about a number of elements, and I'm going to sort of run through this. But before we do anything else, if you've got pen and paper, take it out. If not, just keep a mental map, because I want to do, since this is about education, I want to do a high-stakes multiple-choice test. All right, so there we go. This is what our kids see constantly these days. And what I want to do is to see, you can just do this, there are only four questions, you can do this in your own head. So the question is, which taxes fund our schools? Is it property, is it income, is it sales?
We should be taking this test right now.
Hmm? If you wish, or you can just take it in your own head. Second question is, which government funds our schools? Is it the local, is it the feds, is it the state? And the third, how are those funds actually distributed? Do they go to the district? Do they go to the individual school? Or do they go to the individual student? So those are your three questions. There will be a fourth one in a moment, but write down your answers. And let me ask what the right answers are. Any guesses? Any thoughts?
To number one, or number two, or number three?
Let's start with number one.
It's all of them.
It's all of them?
I think it's income.
Income actually is the least of the three. But what is interesting is that almost no one in Michigan knows the answers to these. These are shockingly complicated questions. What about the second one? Which government funds schools?
See
the state, that's right. And how are the funds distributed?
See.
That's exactly right. So if you ask someone over 65 and they haven't been following the news, they're going to answer this. Because this is the way we used to fund our schools. Overwhelmingly, it was property taxes, it was local, and it was done on the basis of this. So the money came to the district, and it was the district that determined how much money they got. Even then, that wasn't a pure answer, because it was mixed in a whole variety of ways, but that was the main answer, the way things used to be. These days, the answer is C. But mostly, and in fact, as Kurt said, as Mike said, the actual answer for all of them is all of the above. There's the answer to your question. That is the way we fund schools. And that is the kind of complexity that we deal with when we do this. I teach at Wayne. I teach political science at Wayne. I thought I'd studied up when I ran for the Board of Education. I had no idea how complex this stuff was once I started to dive into it. And I've learned that old thing that the only way to really learn something is to try and teach it. Well, I'm trying to do that now. I'm still not sure that I fully understand all of this because it is so astoundingly complicated. There is one that isn't so complicated, which is the question of how funding has changed. Any guesses on this one? Now, Kurt, you clearly weren't watching the Super Bowl. Because if you have been watching the Super Bowl, you would have seen that education funding is up. But, on almost all indicators, almost all fair indicators, almost all ways of understanding how funding has changed, the answer is pretty close that it's down. In almost all ways, no matter how you calculate it, no matter how you spin it, it takes a lot of hard work to come to the conclusion that funding is up, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute. So, we have a very complicated funding structure. We have one simple and unfortunate outcome. And what I want to do is I want to sort of break this apart. There's our line. I want to break this apart into some themes, and then I want to talk about those themes. So the first thing I want to note is that our funding is on the decline. Again, almost any indicator, it's lower than it used to be. It's also, because of the complexity, it's out of local control. There are only a few things that a district like ours can actually do to manage its own revenues. Our expenses are complicated, but our revenues come from really one source and one source only, with a few minor variations. Which means that there's not that much that we can do as a district to control our own revenues unless we go to the source, which is in this case, lands. And it's shockingly complicated. And the fact that it's shockingly complicated means that you can get people saying, well, funding is up, funding is the same, even when funding is down, because it's so strikingly complicated. Also because of the complexity, local districts find themselves having a difficult time managing their own balance between how much comes interested, which was out. And, like Rob just did, stop me at any time, because I want to be able to talk about this in full. Yeah.
So can you have a clear answer if you're talking about universities versus K through 12? I mean, do you, or why not?
What is your clear answer with regard to what?
In terms of, is funding up or funding down?
I think it's down in both categories. Oh. Over the last decade, it's down in both categories. The only way, and we'll talk about this, the only way you can come to the conclusion that it's up is to start at the lowest possible point, which is about 4 years ago, and then not to adjust for inflation. And that's the basis on which the governor's numbers for his ad come from.
Would you repeat that one more time? Because this is what I think you said at the PTA meeting that I found so interesting.
That's right.
So
the governor is a CPA. Mm-hmm. He worked for a major corporation. One of the things he did there was what's called in the business earnings management. So if you have a big corporation and you want to demonstrate to your stockholders that you made a big quarterly profit growth in quarter four, you're going to structure your year so that all those profits show up in quarter four. That's what the governor is actually really good at. What they did was actually to structure the revenues and expenditures so that in the most recent year, which happens to be an election year, it would look like there was lots of growth. But the only way to get that growth...
There was like a 10-year period, did you say?
And you're gonna see that bright. But the only way to get the number of growth is to start, sort of mix your numbers so you start at the lowest possible point, and then not to adjust for any inflation at all. So we're assuming that there's been no inflation. If you take inflation into account, or you start anywhere but that deep low point, you're not gonna get any kind of growth. And in fact, any other assessment is gonna show negative. And depending on how you assess it, that negative is as high as 15 to 20%.
So he's just not factoring in inflation at
he's
all.
He's not. You know, they say figures don't lie, but there are lots of things you can do with figures to make them look the way you want. But let me get into that in a little bit more detail, because
sure.
I think it'll help if we see the actual
sure.
see the actual graph. So these are the four things that I want to talk about to try and explain those four conclusions. I want to talk about how funding has changed. And I actually want to talk about that in two ways. I want to talk about how in terms of actual numbers, and I want to talk about how in terms of the way we actually distribute it. So the method, the amount, and the method. And then that's going to be the bulk of what that's going to be about 20, 25, 30 minutes of what I'm going to do. And then very briefly, I want to talk about why the funding's changed, why you should care, and what you can do about it. Now the answer, obviously, to what you can do about it is come to Lansing with us tomorrow. But if you can't come to Lansing with us tomorrow, there's still other things that you can do. So let me start with the how funding has changed. And I want to talk first in terms of raw numbers. How are we going to look at the amount of money coming into our classrooms compared to what it used to be? Very simple question. The big answer is that there isn't as much. So this is Ferndale's own numbers. And we're going to talk a little bit later about where the money comes from. Most of the money is done per pupil, and there's something called the foundation allowance, which is the amount that a district receives for every one of its students. It's not the only source of money for a district, but it's the biggest by far, the biggest single source of funding for a district. Ferndale's foundation allowance in raw dollars for the since the records have been kept by the states online, 2000, has moved in that kind of arc. So it actually rose through most of the 2000s. Although it didn't rise any faster than inflation. And in fact, if you look at the gray line, that's the inflation line. So whenever the green line is above the gray line, it's doing better than inflation. Whenever it's below, which actually started already in the mid-2000s, whenever it's below, that means that the dollars coming into the classroom, while they may be larger last year in the numbers of zeros attached, are actually smaller in terms of what they can buy. So, and you can see the development from them. You can also see a slight uptick near the very end, and that reflects Governor Snyder's last budget. You would see, and I'm going to put the numbers in for this coming budget, although it's still a proposal, you'd see another uptick. But this isn't accounting for inflation. So what happens if we account for inflation? That'll make the gray line flat, and then we can look at money in terms of what you can actually buy. And it looks like that. So this is our, we can see we did a little bit better than inflation in the early 2000s, and since then it has dropped, and in particular, it had a huge drop. In the late 2000s, early teens. Yes?
What particular policies allowed for that increase in the early 2000s?
Well, the state funded, first of all, a couple things. The school aid fund, which is what the state uses to fund, and I'm going to talk about that in a little more detail. The school aid fund was relatively new. It hadn't been tapped out in a whole variety of ways. where we start to see the cut under is it really in two, in, well, three ways. First of all, the sources of the school aid fund, the things that the school aid fund gets its money from, sales tax, other kinds of things, those started declining because Michigan started to go into a recession during that period. And because the things we fund our schools from are based on those kinds of taxes, when those tax revenues decline, especially sales tax, to a certain extent income tax, we don't get as much money going in. The second thing is that after this point, they started messing with the state taxation formulas so that certain things were exempted. Every time they mess with what's covered by sales tax, less goes in to the school aid fund. There's a sort of bucket where all the money goes. So if, as the state's currently contemplating, you take aviation fuel out of the pot of money that's where you pay sales tax and you pay wholesale or other taxes, then that's a pot of money that doesn't go into the school aid fund. So right now, Aviation Delta, the other airlines, they pay tax on aviation fuel, sales tax on aviation fuel, and a certain amount of that, about $15 million, goes into the school aid fund. When you take that out and move it into another category, as they've done with dozens, literally dozens of little categories, there's less money going in. Then the last thing is that a lot of the money that's coming out used to come out straight for schools. But around this time, after we see the line drop below the gray, it's because they started funding community colleges, universities, pre-K, and other things under that same pot of money that used to be just for K-12. So there's less money going in, both because the economy was in trouble and because they were playing with the tax formulas. And there's more money coming out to other things than there is from K-12. That's an excellent question, and really that's where it comes from. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in detail, but does that kind of get at where you're looking? So this is it. So just Ferndale's raw inflation-adjusted foundation allowance has dropped by 15% from the first year when the record. Actually, it's dropped by slightly more than 15% if we look at that next couple years where there was faster than inflation growth, but 15% just from 2000. Now, I'm not one who takes only one source of information, one source of data. It's part of my sort of my professional training. So I like to look everywhere else I can to see what you can see. So one of the estimates you can look at is the governor's estimate, but quite a few people who've looked at the governor's estimate have said, doesn't adjust for inflation. It starts with that baseline approach, and it does a couple of other things that are a little bit questionable. The source that I actually like here is something called the Citizens Research Council of Michigan. Kurt, you probably know the folks there. Pretty good, pretty nonpartisan. It was started by a guy from Wayne State University who didn't have an ideological axe to grind. He simply wanted to produce better numbers for policy in Michigan. When you look at their numbers, what you see is that the situation is actually slightly worse than what we've been talking about. Now, they use a little bit different time frame and some other stuff. But when I show you the Ferndale raw per pupil allowance, that's just the amount of money coming into the district for each student. What it doesn't take into account is the fact that some of that money has to go elsewhere for reasons mandated by the state or for other reasons. And one of those things is the kind of ungainly acronym called MIPSRS, which I don't even like to say because it sounds pretty odd, but it's the Michigan Public Sector Employees Retirement System, if I've got that right. And this is the pension system for the teachers. Over time, a couple things have happened. First of all, like a lot of pension systems, the Michigan pension system suffered in 2008 when the market collapsed and a lot of the things that were invested in market funds had smaller value. In addition to that, as the state has produced more and more charter schools, people who don't pay into that account, you have the same amount of pensions that you still have to pay for with fewer people paying in. So the costs per school, the cost per pupil for those pensions have been increasing. There's a tiny little sliver on the top that where the state has been helping with those particular costs. But the rest of it is born in that light green band that goes across. And that band is thicker every year. So local schools, the amount of money we get from local schools is diverted in part to pay for higher and higher pension costs every single year. This isn't adjusted for inflation. When we adjust it for inflation, we get that. So we get a really significant decline in the actual amount, not just that the schools get, but that the schools can spend on pensions. So there are different ways of calculating this. This is one way of calculating it, but it's a pretty significant decline. And then there's another group called Michigan Parents for Schools, and if you don't follow education, but you want to, I think this is a pretty good group. Now, I will be honest, this is a group that encourages higher funding for public education. They tend to be on the side of the teachers as opposed to the state. They tend to be aligned more with the Democratic Party than the Republican Party. If that doesn't bother you, they're also pretty honest and pretty fair. And they tend not to cook their numbers to get the answers that they want. So when they run their numbers, and they use aggregate numbers as opposed to the specific numbers we've been using before, what they find is about a 19% decline. Again, every one of these uses a different starting point, they use a different ending point, so the numbers are all slightly different, but the basic trend is exactly the same. What they show is a significant decline over time of about 19%. The little red marks there are from the Obama Recovery Act, the ARRA. And so at that time, as states' numbers were imploding, the federal government stepped in to supplement, but that money stopped a couple of years ago. It's not there anymore. And so you see a pretty sharp decline after that. That really saved our bacon in the late 2000s, early teens. But since that's gone away, we've seen a continued drop. Now, as Michigan's economy stabilized, you see a stabilization in the numbers. The numbers aren't going down anymore, but again, keep in mind, this isn't adjusted. This isn't adjusted for inflation. So it's quite significant. And the same thing is true when you look at the numbers closer up, and you look at the per pupil numbers. Because during that time, admittedly, there has been a drop in the number of students in Michigan schools, quite precipitous in the mid-2000s. But even when you factor that, you get about an 8.9% decline, depending on how you calculate it. So this is the state of Michigan education. No matter which set of numbers you look at, how you look at it, you see an overall decline. And I just got today new numbers from the House Fiscal Agency. So this is the House of Representatives of Michigan, and it shows that exact same trend.
What is the green state
general? The green is the great state. So I'm going to talk a little bit about this. But Michigan's education budget is primarily paid for something called the School Aid Fund. Some additional monies come sometimes from the general fund to top it up if something goes, if the state aid fund drops especially or for other reasons. Most of that additional state aid fund is going for pensions. So that's not money that's going into classrooms. He's taking credit for it, but that's primarily money that's going to fund a system that the state has helped to undermine and raise the cost. So this is the general pattern. Michigan Parents for Schools also has a nice graph, and I need to rework this so it's a little bit clearer, because they put far too many things on it. And someone who does data will know. But I grabbed this because I wanted to just show you a little bit. Two things have happened, and actually your question, sir, asks about why it's been declining faster than inflation. Part of it's the money going in, but part of it's the money going out. So if you see that orange band that goes across, that reflects the diversion of money from what's the kindergarten through 12 school aid fund, into higher education. And so all of that money, if you left that money back in, if you didn't take it out in the first place and funded universities out of the general fund where they used to be funded, and I work at a university, I love it when the state funds us, but I don't want them to fund us at the college level on the backs of the kids who are coming to my college. They're not gonna get there if they don't have these kinds of funding. So this doesn't do us a lot of good. So they've done that. The other one is what would have happened if the state hadn't messed with the state business, the single business tax, which provided money into the state funds. So if they hadn't messed with that tax, it would have risen, and it would have risen at a rate that looked like about or a little bit higher than inflation, but probably just about inflation. If you were really going to account for all the costs, it would have to rise slightly faster than inflation, because pension costs are rising faster than inflation, and healthcare costs are rising faster than inflation. So you really want to see that green line slightly above the gray line. But you're not seeing it. If they hadn't messed with the single business tax, or if they compensated for that decline, we would be pretty much where we ought to be. But they decided that could go away, and they didn't need to fund the schools for that particular amount. So if you actually look at both the blue category and the orange category, it answers almost precisely your question. So no matter how you slice it, we see a decline. Second thing I want to talk about, and this is where things get complicated, so either tell me to go faster, or tell me to stop and explain what the hell I'm talking about. Because this is the method by which things have changed. And this is where heads explode. So in order to do that, I want to start with this year, 1994. Because this year is the watershed year for shaping Michigan education funding. In fact, It's one of the biggest years in any state's education funding in terms of the amount of change, how they changed the formula. Because 1994 was the year something called Proposition A. Some of you probably remember Proposition A. There have been so many propositions over time, but this for this kind of thing, this is the big one. So what I want to talk about is what it's like before Proposition A, because that's what a lot of people think it's still like, and what it's like after Proposition A. So what it was like before. Before Proposition A, state funding was primarily, education funding was primarily local, about 64%. Some of it from the state, some of it from the federal government, about 4% from the federal government. So that's the amount on top. Now this money has actually increased over time, and I'll talk a little bit about that. But as far as schools go, this money is very restricted. When the federal government gives you money, it gives you money on a very, you can use it for this or that, something else. And a number of you work in systems that take federal money, I know. You don't get a choice about what to do with it. If it's for Head Start, you spend it on Head Start. And not only for Head Start, you spend it on buying construction paper for Head Start students because that's what it says you're supposed to do. So you don't get a lot of choice out of this, and it really depends on what it's for. It's for particular reasons. Before Proposition A, the second largest was a big mix of various state funding that included some sales tax funding, some income tax funding, the lottery, tobacco, martinis, alcohol, industrial facilities, and so on. So you get a whole variety, a whole big mix, and that accounted for just less than one-third of the total funding for schools in the state. There was a kind of formula that would give it out on a per-pupil basis or per-district basis for some of it, per-pupil for others, but it was still a fairly minor part. And then the huge part of this was property tax. So those of you who lived in Michigan before 1994, you may remember property tax bills. Those property tax bills, a lot of those went for education. There was some criticism in Michigan at about this time, for about the decade preceding 1994, that Michigan's property taxes were too high. And there is some evidence to suggest that they were at least higher than the national average compared to other kinds of taxes, at least. And so there was a lot of discontent about Michigan property taxes, and education was one of the biggest recipients of those property taxes. So over time, what we saw was a lot of controversy about this one. In fact, we saw so much controversy that over about a 15-year period, there were 12 different attempts on the ballot. So those of you who were voting here in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, were 12 different, it's like an alphabet soup. I mean, you have almost every letter is represented, and every one of them failed. Every single one, all 12. Now, the margin of failure declined slightly, so that by 1993, they only lost by 4%, but there were various proposals, various types and ways of doing this, and they all failed. In 1993, certain legislators got fed up with this, and in particular, on both the Democratic side and the Republican side, there were thoughts about changing it and doing away with it. And one of these was a proposal made by a fairly young state legislator at the time named Debbie Stabenow. Who said, really tried to call the bluff of the other side and say, look, you don't like property taxes funding education, then we'll get rid of it. Never expecting that they would go along with it. But the other side called her bluff, calling their bluff, and they said, okay, fine, we'll get rid of it. And they got rid of it without putting anything in its place. The Wall Street Journal, not a bastion of left-wing political thought, found this to be absolutely absurd. They literally got rid of two-thirds of all funding for education. They banned it in Michigan without providing a replacement. Which forced, for good or for bad, forced something to happen. So in 1994, the state legislature gave people a choice. They were allowed to choose between what was called a statutory alternative. So if they didn't vote on the proposal, this is what they would have gotten. And it was an addition that was primarily in the form of state sales tax and increases in the state income tax, a couple of other things. And then on the other side, Proposition A, which I'm going to talk about, was a very complicated resolution. And complicated precisely because of the fact that they needed to win it. Because there wasn't a really good alternative. They were either going to go to this or something new. And in order to win that alternative, they had to make lots of compromises, lots of deals, and they ended up with a very complicated system, the one that I'm going to talk about. The result was that, unlike any of the previous 12, Proposition 8 succeeded. It actually won by more than two-thirds of the vote, and it won in every single Michigan county. But in order to win in every single Michigan county, you'll see the kinds of compromises that they had to make to get that level of victory. So, what I want to talk about for about 10 minutes is how this actually changed. We're getting rid of property taxes as the basis for school funding. So they shifted to something else, particularly the state. They'd shift that funding to the state level. Instead of doing it by district or by school, they would do it by student. So every student who has a certain amount of dollars that follow him or her around. And with some exceptions, particularly at the low level, they would keep to existing levels of funding. So they would raise the bottom up a little bit, but for the most part, schools would be done at existing levels, and overall levels of spending wouldn't be that different for. So it wasn't like Proposition A made all these changes and then added a lot of money to schools. It did at the bottom end for a lot of very poor rural districts. Interestingly, a lot of the schools we think of as poor didn't have low levels of funding at that particular point. Detroit, Southfield, a lot of others were sort of in the middle of the pack. The really poor districts were the ones where voters were refusing to pay for their local millages. And in fact, I think in 1992 or 1993, Kalkaska actually just voted no on their millage. So there was no funding for local education in Kalkaska during that period until Proposition A stepped in to take over. So for the most part, they kept it at existing levels because this wasn't about how much we spend on education. It was about how we spend the money and where it comes from. So they weren't thinking in terms of what do we need to fund education. They were just thinking in terms of where it comes from. In reality, it was a little more complicated. And every time I say something, you can scratch the surface and I'd have to say, well, it's not quite that simple. So some of it was left in property taxes. Some of it was left at the local level. Other funds were added into this, and the levels that districts received didn't always correspond to what they received before. At the bottom end, at the top end, even at the. So, I think the best way to look at this is to look at some graphs, to look at some numbers. The difference in actual funding wasn't that great. So there wasn't much more funding going into education after than before, depending on how you calculate it. Some have suggested there was even less. I tend to agree with those estimates that see a little bit more, but it wasn't a lot. So it was a very minor increase. What was different was the way that the money was distributed. Because whereas before it had been primarily local, after it was primarily state. So you can see the state share increases from a third to almost four-fifths, and the local share decreases from two-thirds to about a fifth. So you see a big difference. Fundamental difference in the way these are allocated. What I want to do is talk about the bottom two. Federal money, fairly fixed. You see a big change in the early 2000s with the emergence of No Child Left Behind. What that really does is to increase the federal share to about a tenth, maybe an eighth. But the really big differences and the really big amounts of money, again, because the federal money is so constricted, so limited, is really in the allocation of the state and the local levels. That's what I want to talk about. What I want to do is take that 78%, or look at that 78%, which is what we call the school aid fund. So we have something in Michigan, I mentioned it, called the school aid fund. This is kind of the pail where the school money goes, and then that pail is dumped out on school districts by student, on the student level, most of it, in any case. So that's the biggest share. Then we have a little bit that's at the local level, but I'll talk about that in a minute. So just this 78%, think about where it comes from, and what that looks like. So let's think about first about where it comes from. We'll think about the sources. And the sources of this new state aid fund, where the state aid fund existed, but the new sources, according to Proposition A, were different than before. First thing they did, and you may remember this if you were around in Michigan in 1994, was that the state sales tax went up by 2%. And virtually all of that 2% went straight into the school aid fund. So about 50% of the total amount of state funding for schools, which is about four-fifths of the overall amount, comes from sales tax. This is a really recession-sensitive indicator. When people stop buying stuff, this drops. It doesn't drop as fast as property values, but it drops pretty fast. It drops faster than income, for example, and a variety of other things. So about 46% of it is sales tax, and then 3% of it is use tax. So let me ask you guys, how many of you pay your use tax? Do you know what your use tax is? Any idea? buy from Amazon? If you buy anything out of state, out of the country, from another planet, anything, you are supposed to pay the value of that, 6% on the value of that. You can actually register online, you can register with the state, you can pay that particular amount, and you're supposed to actually. And so far it's quasi-voluntary, they don't go after you if you don't. But just know, if you start to feel civically minded, that all of that money goes into the school aid fund. So it goes for a good cause, it comes right back into the community. So now if you're looking for some way to feel morally superior to your neighbors, you can start paying it. You may not have a choice much longer. There are some proposals to change this around and to require this. And there's actually been controversy about if they do that, whether that'll go to the school aid fund or if it'll go somewhere else, like roads or something else. So, but that is the use tax. About 3%, apparently there are some people, and corporations and others do pay their use tax because they're more easily targeted. Those things do go, and they constitute about 3% of overall spending on schools. Another 20% comes from income tax, so straight off the top into the school aid fund. Another 18% is real estate related, and that means property tax. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. And this is just property tax at the state level. So if you look at your property tax bill, there will be an item on it that says state education tax. So that's a state property tax. It's pretty unusual in the United States to have a property tax is usually at the local level. This is a state level property tax, and it constitutes a pretty significant amount of the other part is a real estate transfer tax. So every time you buy and sell a house, a small share of that actually goes into this fund also. Again, another highly recession-sensitive indicator, or recession-sensitive source of revenue, because when people stop buying and selling their houses, you don't get this money that goes into them. Or when property values drop, because it's a percentage-wise, you don't get that anywhere as well. And then the top, you've got some odd little categories, lotteries and casinos. Lotteries are about 6%, casinos are about 1%. A lot of people think that lottery funds, the way they market themselves, people think, oh, why do we need extra funding? The lottery funds our schools. It funds 6% of our schools.
Was that the original, when they were selling it to us, was that the original idea, 6%?
Well, it was never, even back before Proposition A, it was never that big. It was a little bit bigger share back then. I mean, I think they marketed it on the notion that all of the lottery money went into education, but some people have taken the other way around to think that all of the education money comes from the lottery. Which is probably a good thing, because the lottery preys on precisely the people who are getting a bad education in math. So it's a problem. And then finally, there are about 3% for tobacco and about 1% for various other. Yeah.
So does that mean that lottery money go into the general fund and not spend that?
I don't know. I don't know the answer to that. I need to find that out. So if you want to think about it in relatively simple terms, about half of all money for education in the state aid fund comes from sales tax. About a fifth comes from income tax. About a fifth comes from property tax. And then the rest comes from risky behavior, whether that's the lottery or smoking. That's about $1 out of every 10, one dime out of every dollar is how it was paid. This is just at the state level. But again, remember, the state level is four-fifths of all of our education funding. So that total amount is what goes into the state aid fund. There is also an additional 18% that I talked about here at the local level. And you might think that's not loose change. That's 20%, that's one-fifth of the total amount. And that amount seems theoretically to be in local control. So we can maybe do something about that. Unfortunately, the answer is not quite that simple. So let's look at that 18% real quick. And here's where it starts to get complicated, because this is where a lot of compromises and other things were made, as if it weren't complicated enough, right? So here's where it starts to get really complicated. Before Proposition A, two-thirds of all education funding was paid for with property tax, and that was an average of about 34 mills on your property. So if you think of your property values, that's about $34 on every $1,000 of property value. Now it's about, the way it's estimated, it's $34 on every half of your total valuation. But that's the average that it was before. In some districts it was considerably higher, some districts it was considerably lower. But it didn't matter what kind of property, it was all pretty much the same. After Proposition A, and this was precisely the point of Proposition A, was to reduce property taxes. So these dropped significantly. So after Proposition A, six mills are levied on what's called your homestead, which is your primary residence and nothing else. And the remaining 24, and non-homestead, the remaining kinds of property, non-homestead, are assessed at a level of up to 24 months. So there's a maximum of 24 months. So this was the property tax relief. We paid for it in other ways. We paid for it with sales tax and income tax and other stuff. But this was the property tax relief that they were seeking. Now this actually is complicated because I mentioned before that about 18% of the overall education funding is done by the state level levy property tax. So the state levies property tax at 6 mills, whether it's homestead or not homestead. So this is not at the local level. So we can exclude that for the moment, and we can just get to this. Localities, therefore, levy on property. On homestead property, nothing. On non-homestead property, up to 18 mills. And it works like this. A locality for non-homestead property, and that means a farm, a rental housing, a business property, and so on. They can't levy anything over 18. It's simply not allowed, not acceptable. So they're capped out at 18. A locality can levy less than 18, but they don't get that money back from it. So they're permitted to levy up to 18. Almost every, if not every, municipality in the state levies at that full 18. They're allowed to go that high and no higher, and almost all of them do. Just as an aside, so you can see that the control is sharply limited. As an aside, one of the things that has to happen periodically is that every municipality has to renew its non-homestead property tax. And the Ferndale School District is no exception. Our past one, it was a 20-year, actually expires within the next 2 years. So sometime within the next 2 years, in order to keep that funding at the level it is, this is 1/5 of our total funding, you should expect to see from the school district a millage on the ballot. It'll just continue what's there, and it'll only be on non-homestead property. These are fairly uncontroversial. I can't think of a single example of a place where a municipality has voted no, but it still has to go on the ballot. Yeah.
Right. So if you just own one home, your home, you don't pay this piece of it.
You don't pay this piece of it.
And you pay the state education tax.
You pay the 6 mil state education tax. You don't pay any other property taxes for operating, for classroom expenses, okay, for the district. But there are three exceptions, and that's what I want to just briefly mention. Because some of you may say, wait, don't I pay more in education fund? You actually do, but for different reasons, and it goes for different things. So there are three exceptions to this. Those are the ones that I want to talk about. So the first exception is something called hold harmless exception. The hold harmless exception is this, and some of you, how many of you have heard the notion of hold harmless? Most of you have heard it in one form or another. When the state started paying per pupil instead of per district, it set a maximum amount. $6,500 was the amount that it set in terms of, that would be about $9,500 in current money, a little bit less. But in order not to lose support from all of those districts that were actually, because of their own millages at the time, bringing in more than that per pupil, they decided to let those districts, and there were about 50 of them, they decided to let those districts tax their own populations at a higher level if they wanted to. So let me briefly actually show this, because this is actually fairly important. Theoretically, we should be able to do this. Let's see if it works. So, this is how a hold harmless works. There are a couple of interludes that I've got because I realize people have questions about things. You're getting the full version, you may regret that. So, hold harmless. When the state decided to do this, districts below the cap, districts that were below the $6,500 per pupil when they calculated it out in 1994, they can never tax their localities for operating classroom expenses. They simply can't do it. Ferndale's one of those districts. So we are not in that particular category. We can't ever do it. Districts that were doing more can tax their localities, they can tax their citizens, but only if the citizens agree in a millage motion. Now here, sometimes localities actually do vote no on these. They say, we're not going to pay over the whole harmless amount. We're only going to pay something smaller. But that's also fairly rare. What this means is that you have a whole bunch of districts in the state, 52 districts in the state, that because they were above that level in 1994, are still allowed to go above that level. None of the others are. So there is a kind of built-in inequality in school per pupil funding because that inequality existed before and because they had to deal with that in order to get the thing passed. For Ferndale, this is particularly sensitive. There's Ferndale, this is Oakland County. The districts that are held harmless are those. So the only districts around us that are not held harmless are districts with significantly lower per capita income. Chris was at the Madison School District, among others. Hazel Park, Oak Park, and then Berkeley. And Berkeley has a level that's a little bit higher than ours, but not in that hold harmless category. And then all of the rest of these have hold harmless. Sometimes reaching as high, I think it can fulfill up to $11,000, whereas Ferndale's is $7,700. So this is a big difference. As Mary Schuster Bauer, who's on the Board of Education, pointed out, these are always the school districts who, when you talk about the state per pupil funding, say, well, it's not about money, it's about other stuff than money. To which her response was always, well, then give us some of yours, and we'll just call it even. But as Ferndale's trying to compete with the school districts around it for test scores, for student enrollment, this is what we're doing. So it's a big deal, and it's a potentially big problem for us. Let me go back to what I was doing before. And so this one, we can't do that. It's simply out of our hands. We're not allowed to be held harmless. We're held hostage instead of harmless. The second is debt. So we can actually, districts can actually, for very limited reasons, borrow money, and they can ask the voters to support that borrowing of money with a millage. This is what Ferndale did in 2012. The money has to be spent in a very, very limited period of time, so you've got to sort of stock up all your big projects, and it can only be spent on what's called capital projects. So things like fixing the boiler systems in the high school, taking the asbestos out of that school, anything that involves construction, you can do it. They've extended that now to involve technology, security, and a couple of other things, but none of this goes for in the classroom stuff. Now we do this because every dollar that we get from one of these bond issues means that we don't have to take money out of the classroom to pay for the boiler. But this is the only thing. And because we just did one, we're not going to get a chance to do one probably for a significant amount of time. Now the good news is we actually just refinanced because of low interest rates. We refinanced our bonds and we actually saved $1.2 million. We thought we were only going to save about $800,000. We saved $1.2 million. So that means that the period at which we're going to pay off our bonds comes sooner, but it's still not going to come that soon. And so we're looking at 10 to 15 years before we can do this again. So for the future, at least, we don't have any control of that. That one's out. Yes?
Now, you're saying you can't go do that again because it wouldn't be acceptable.
No, there's actually a legal limit in the state that's based on property values. And it's based on an estimation of the change in property values over the last 5 years. So for the next 2 years, just given what's happened, those changes are going to be negative. Those are going to be negative for a significant amount of time because we've got these huge losses. You're really going to have to get those off. So for at least 4 years, we're not even going to be able to think about it because they set a certain limit about how much you can indebt yourself. After that, we could for tiny amounts, but those kinds of millages often are problematic. So in order to get it up to the point where you could do a significant millage and actually accomplish something, is probably 10 to 15 years. So for the big stuff, now, what we've tried to do with this past millage is to invest in such a way that we're not going to need to do that kind of big stuff for the next 10 years. We're getting asbestos out of the high school, we're redoing the heating and cooling systems, we did the auditorium and so on. But things happen. So, for example, the Jackson, which is CASA, boiler is currently dying. We didn't know it was dying when we went for this millage. Fortunately, we designed the millage in such a way that it involved heating and cooling expenses, and we can use some of that to pay for the Jackson boiler. But if another boiler in another facility goes, or something else happens, that money's going to come straight out of classroom education. We're not going to be able to easily go for a bond. Which leads us to the last category, and this is the one thing that this local district has not done. and take advantage of the very, very limited flexibility that localities have. It's called a sinking fund, which is almost, seems almost designed to make it sound unpalatable, right? This is the sort of Titanic fund. But really what this means is sinking in the sense of investment. You raise money at a small level every year, you can use that to do sort of ongoing repairs and ongoing change. We haven't done this. There are some who would like to do this. Some have proposed that we actually ask the voters for this. That is, right now, it's something that's in very, very preliminary discussion. But it's something you may hear about. When you hear about sinking fund, though, no, it's not that the district is sinking. That it is simply a way of talking about funds that are invested in capital repairs that can be done. We've got to work with what we've got unless we can get the money, the revenues really at the state level change, because there's not much else we can do at the local level. The only other way to change your revenue is to change the number of students. It's done on a per pupil basis. And this is why districts all across the state are fiercely competing with one another to the extent of marketing, fierce marketing, flyers that everybody gets in their doors. And all of you have seen these. Every district around us, Berkeley, Madison Heights, charter schools, they are all competing for students because they know that's the only way that they can raise their revenue. And so we're put in a situation where schools have to compete like Coke or Meijer or anything else, but at the same time, schools have certain things that they are required by law to do, unlike Coke or Meijer or anything else. So it's really kind of the worst of both worlds. Where does this money go? This is actually a fairly simple part of the story. Most of it comes back to schools in the form of the per pupil foundation allowance. Ferndale's is right now, this year, it's $7,758 per pupil. Next year it'll go up by, we think, about 97, depending on whether the budget's improved, so about 7,800. Some districts are considerably higher. Some districts are a little bit lower. And the state, when they went to Proposition A, set a bottom. That bottom is around 7,000. So Ferndale is a little bit above the bottom, actually, thanks to pretty good choices of millages in the 60s, 70s, and 80s. But we're certainly not at the hold harmless limit, and we're certainly not above that, so that we could get that additional extra amount. In addition to that per pupil amount, there is some money that comes back in what's called categoricals. Categoricals are money that comes back for specific purposes. It's like the federal money, only at the state level. So special education transportation, some other limited transportation funding. Some money for students with financial need, some money for students who are in poverty, intense poverty areas and so on. So there are some money that do come from the state. Those monies do help compensate to a certain extent for districts that have students who are more costly to educate, but there is a real question out there, and honestly we don't know the answer, whether they compensate enough. And the guess is that they probably don't compensate enough. But there hasn't been a good study on this. Pennsylvania, Maryland, a whole bunch of other states have done studies on this. Michigan hasn't done it, no. I'll talk about that in a minute, but our state rep, Ellen Coben-Lipton, has actually put a bill to do that on the table in the House Education Committee, and we'll see where it goes. So that's where it is. So that's the how, finally, and I'm almost done. Why has it changed? Actually, I don't have to spend a lot of time on this because of your street question from early on. First reason is that revenue sources were reduced, partly by the nature of the economy. Really, we had a 10-year recession in the state, but also because the state has monkeyed with the formula so that money coming into the school aid fund isn't what it used to be. Lots of things have been exempted. Most recently, our Speaker of the House proposed legislation that when you sell a used car and buy a new one, at the moment you're actually taxed on the difference between your new car and your used car. According to House Speaker Bolger, that's unfair, and so that was removed. Whether it's unfair or not, what that means is that money that you would have paid on the difference between your new car and your trade-in is no longer taxed by sales tax, and it no longer comes into the school aid fund. Every one of these, and there's a whole list of them, even in 2013, I think there were 8 or 9 of them, that together cost about $49 million from the school aid fund. Not a huge amount, but not insignificant. And that's been happening over the last 10 years. So there have been reductions in the revenue. Various sources disappear from the particular revenue from the funds. The other is the diversion of spending away, and this was the other part of your question. Both at the university level, And at the pre-K level, and the governor in the last 2 years has increased funding, $65 million, which again isn't a huge amount, but it's something. But all that money comes out of the K through 12 school aid fund. It's mainly about teachers. Most of our budget in the Ferndale School District goes to pay for teachers, administrators, and staff. And unless you're gonna switch to an online model, which frankly, I'd say as a teacher, doesn't work very well, there are not a lot of other options. You need a certain number of human beings in the classroom for each student. So there's not much that schools can do to reduce their personnel expenses, and if the things that are associated with personnel, like healthcare and pensions, are rising faster than inflation, school expenses are gonna rise faster than inflation. Now, if costs can be brought under control, if other teachers could be brought into that mixer system, those from charter schools and elsewhere, it might mitigate some of these extra costs. That's not happening. It's not happening.
So, okay.
Yeah.
Just to play devil's advocate.
Yeah.
So the cost for personnel, pensions,
right,
healthcare costs. So if you project that into the future, we're doomed.
Well, doomed is a strong word, but it certainly doesn't look great. Now, those costs have actually been rising less fast in the last couple years than they had in the past.
But rising nonetheless.
Rising nonetheless. Now, they're rising at an incremental rate, 2-3% faster than inflation, so on. But you're right, and this is why. I mean, if this is something that we as a state want to do, if we want to educate our children up to a certain level, then we have to actually figure out how we're going to fund our schools at a level that's going to compensate for those costs. That's what we haven't been doing. Frankly, we've been nickel and diming it and cutting it. Karen.
It should also be noted when it relates to the retirement that one of the contributing factors is that we as schools have been under increased pressure to privatize a lot of our personnel, which has been kicking people out of the retirement system. Not only that, but charter schools aren't required to be in the same retirement system either, so that the ratio has now reduced from 2.5 down to 1.23 for those in the retirement system. And so that sort of imbalance is what's adding to the cost of retirement. So some people argue that one of the ways that you can lower that retirement cost is to actually let people back in so that there's more people sharing that cost and burden.
And there is actually in the Bridge magazine, which is an online magazine this week, a recommendation that we figure out a way to bring charter school teachers back in. Michigan has one of the highest rates of charter schools in the country, and the highest, if I'm not mistaken, rate of for-profit charter schools in the country.
80% are for profit.
Yeah. So that if some of those teachers were brought back into the system or were put into the system, you would have more younger teachers sharing the cost of paying for pensions, and that would continue on theoretically. I don't know that we can get back to that. But that's there doesn't seem to be any political will move in that direction. And it may be that we simply acknowledge the fact that these costs are going up. When other costs go up, we acknowledge them. We don't say, those damn roads, they keep asking for more and more money, like we do with teachers. We acknowledge that certain kind of costs go up, and we cover those costs. In this case, I think some found an easy sort of group to blame, regarded those groups or portrayed them as privileged, and used that as a basis to say that we're not going to increase funding. They got it. The districts have to eat the money. They have to eat the loss, even though that means less money per class expenditure. And then the suggestion is that, there are cheaper ways to educate students. You can use technology, you can use other things. I think those guesses have yet to prove successful, at least yet to prove successful for students that really need it. To the extent that technology has any kind of cost-saving and quality effects, even just maintaining existing quality, it tends to be for those students who are already at the top of the scale, not the ones at the bottom of the scale. And that's a big problem. My fear is that what we end up with, and I say this not as I'm just trying to explain the system, but my own personal opinion, that we end up with a system where the poor get technology, not very well functioning technology, and the wealthy get individual teachers who can look them in the eye and help them and do what teachers usually used to do. But that we're going to find cheaper alternatives, not as good, but cheaper alternatives, which have a little flash and dash to them because they you have to plug them in. But they don't work as well. And it's precisely those students who need the human touch who aren't going to get it. That's the other downside of what we're doing. The other thing, Karen actually alludes to this, and I think some others have talked about this as well, is that in addition to all of these other factors, there are costs to school districts that are involved in simply having to compete constantly with other school districts. We used to have to do this. Now, in the past, you also didn't have a lot of choice. You didn't like the schools that your children go to. You could choose a parochial school, and that was about it. There are more choices now. You can do other things. But the downside to that additional choice is that school districts have to behave as if they are for-profit companies, and they have to constantly compete with others for students. This has a particularly negative consequence in districts with slow-growing or declining populations, like Ferndale. And Ferndale's isn't declining. We're actually pretty fixed. Even our school-age population is projected to grow ever so slightly over the next 5 years. After that, to decline slightly and then to grow slightly again. But for districts like ours, where there aren't a lot of new students coming in, for certain districts like Novi, I would expect, and some others, where there are lots of students coming in, this isn't such a big deal. For districts with fixed enrollments, roughly fixed enrollments, where they're vulnerable to poaching, frankly, by other districts, you can see in any given year a significant enrollment drop. The money's tied to the students. So when students leave, the money goes with them. So if a certain number of students leave, you see a significant drop in revenue. The costs of a district are mostly fixed. Just because a bunch of students aren't there doesn't mean you don't need roughly the same number of teachers, roughly the same number of buildings, and so on. So what schools are now exposed to is the fact that they have very rapidly changing revenue streams, sometimes up, sometimes down, and very slowly changing expenditures. And so for a school district where you don't see a lot of inflow, you have the problem of what to do when in any given year the outflow is very high. We saw the example, and Mary Schusterbauer reminded me of it, we saw the example of the former St. James Church, which was turned into a charter school. Quite a significant number of students from the Ferndale School District jumped to that district, or jumped to that charter school, found very quickly that it wasn't meeting their needs, and after count day, which is the day on which we do this in September, jumped back. The consequence of that was that that school kept the revenue for that year. Those students came back to the Ferndale district, which not only suffered the loss of the revenue, but then actually had to educate those students also. So you get very rapid fluctuations in your revenue, and very slow fixed changes in your expenditures. Which if you're on the receiving end, that's really nice. If you're on the other end, even if it's for a short period of time, it can lead you to significant financial difficulty. And I think it's not a surprise that Moody's, these are not sort of left-wing people who wear tie-dyes. These are people who want to know whether you're going to pay your bonds back or not. Moody's sees significant problems with Michigan schools of choice system because of the financial stresses that it puts on districts, because the revenues move much faster than the expenditures. So even these folks see that this is a problem. And it's pretty instructive to read their bond issue report, which wasn't intended as an education document, but it's very interesting to read that as a document about how do you understand what's going on in the schools these days. That wasn't their goal, but it tells us a lot about the system. All right, last two things, super quick. Why should you care? I think it's pretty obvious. First is, Proposition A didn't start by saying how much money do we need. Proposition A started by saying how much money do districts get. We're going to lift the lower ones, mainly the lower rural ones, and the rest are going to stay more or less the same, even if it means they have to do a whole harmless milling. So this was never done on the basis of financial adequacy, and there was never a question about, is this enough to begin? It probably wasn't. So that's our first thing, that there just isn't enough money. Second, there's less than there was then. So it's been declining since that period, especially since 2000, we see a significant decline over time, and it's not even keeping pace with inflation. In fact, it's falling significantly faster than inflation. Except now, in an election year, when it's sort of convenient to raise those.